I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Stanton Forbes' bizarre retrospective tale of entanglement. If two of them are dead. Starring Earl Holloway. Catherine Burns. And Nina Foch as Sister Love. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Ford Motor Company, MEM, and Sign-Off. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
The Depression of the 1930s. A time of hopelessness, a time of fear. Fear, an unfortunate catalyst. One likely to bring more of the same for Dorcas Kimball. Dorcas Kimball. She waits in a dark cyclone cellar, clinging to the only security she has left in the world. A small bag of gold coins. Alone and frightened, ready to strike down Joe John Plunkett, the very man who could be her only hope of escape. The conclusion of If Two of Them Are Dead follows after this word.
Poor Dorcas. You poor little girl. Ever since I showed up, I've been cursing my own bad luck. Then while I was standing there on the cellar steps, in the pitch dark, it first occurred to me, her luck wasn't all that much to speak of either. Hell, she'd met me, the fighter of the 13th of humanity.
Dorcas?
When you're in there, Georgie, if you don't come in, so I got me a break and I'll use it on you if I have to.
Well, it would serve me right if you did. I should just get the hell out of here while I got the chance.
But what do you want, JoJo? You answer me before I heed this breath.
I'm not after that money of yours, if that's what you're thinking.
And what'd you come down here after me for?
To warn you about Sister Love.
What about her?
I was right about Tippy. She killed him on purpose. She must have some kind of poison, and she put it in Tippy's food last night.
What? Just because he barked at her?
No, she hated it. But that's not the reason she poisoned it.
Why'd she do it then?
Because she's got plans. And we just don't figure them. At least not the way she told us we were going to.
You mean she's not going to think about that?
No, she's sure not.
That's funny. I never really believed it anyway. I mean, it wasn't like my money from Great Aunt Nadine. But I knew what it felt like to hold it in my hand, and I could think about it, spending it whenever I wanted.
Well, it's not just the money, Dorcas. Sister Love is evil. I mean, she's liable to do anything.
Yeah, I know that. She killed Tippy, didn't she? I can't decide if you're my friend or not.
You shouldn't count on anybody.
Well, that's why I came down here after my money. It's the only thing I got now to give up. That's why I picked up that brick when I heard you come.
Yeah, well, that was smart. But I think you and I just better stick together till we can figure out what to do about Sister Love.
But what can we do?
I don't know. I don't know yet. But for now, we better get back up to the house.
I'll have to take my money with me. I don't want to have to come down here anymore.
Yeah, well, hang on to it. You may need it.
JoJo?
Yeah?
I could have hit you with that one. I just couldn't have done it.
Never mind about that. Come on, let's go. What she said was probably true. She probably couldn't have used that brick. Sister Love sure as hell would have, and I could have too if I'd had to. But Dorcas, no. No, she probably couldn't. And maybe that made her worth saving. Only what could I do to save her? And why not just save Joe John Plunkett? I mean, even an old piece of driftwood has its uses. And who knows, maybe the next jump I made off some freight train might mean good luck. Well, this one had sure been bad luck. Bad luck in spades. Yeah, there'd been some good luck along the line, I still remember. Like San Angelo, Bessie Spruill. First, that had looked like I struck out again, too. Hopping down off that freight to find the only car on the road was this old girl's jalopy. Stopped dead with a tire fluttering my bankroll.
Mister, look, I know fixing the flat for an old broad like me is something you could live without, but I'll give you a lift into town in exchange. And if you've got the time to spare, you're welcome to take supper with my old man and me. I know my way around the kitchen pretty good.
That turned out to be an understatement. For the next 6 weeks, I never ate so good. Turned out Bessie's old man was laid up with a bum back, and Bessie needed somebody to help her run this miniature golf course until it got better. I guess maybe that was the sweetest 6 weeks of my life. What made me think of it now, I wondered. Bessie Spruill and her old man in San Angelo were a long way from Sister Laura fixing a pitcher of lemonade in Dorcas Kimball's kitchen. And that was a question to put my mind to. When I got inside the house, now why had Sister Love turned domestic all of a sudden? She didn't know her way around the kitchen, as far as I knew. Maybe little Tippy knew better. And I thought some about that. Lemonade, huh? Amen.
It was spooky the way the two of them just sort of stared at each other without talking. She kept stirring the lemonade, and he just looked at her, right at her. And not like he was thinking she was real beautiful, either.
You keep stirring, that's going to wear that spoon off.
I was thirsty, and I wasn't going to wait forever. Whatever you and Dorcas were doing outside took you long enough.
Dorcas, you better go get out of those wet clothes. She's been standing out by Tippy's grave in the rain.
Sentimental foolishness over a dog. Well, it's done, except for the sugar. We can all have some in a moment.
I didn't dare take my eyes off Sister Love's hands. I watched her spoon the sugar into the pitcher, stir the mixture, and then take three clean glasses out of the cupboard. Two of them, I felt sure, we're going to end up containing something a little more potent than lemonade.
The rain's stopping. I'm glad. Tippy never liked being out in the rain.
Oh, God. Can't you forget that dog?
I'll never forget that dog.
Here, I'll pour the lemonade.
No, it isn't quite chilled enough. I'll just set it in the icebox for now. We'll have it a little later.
Guess I will go change my clothes after all.
We'll wait for you.
You come right back. Listen, Dorcas wants out of the deal.
What?
$1,000. Whether you got it or not, Dorcas doesn't want any part of it.
Why are you telling me this? Why doesn't Dorcas tell me herself?
Well, she's afraid of you.
Afraid of me?
Yeah, I know. That seems unbelievable to you, but she's just a child, you know?
Oh, 17 isn't exactly a child.
15. She just admitted it to me.
Have you been filling her with some of those wild notions of yours about me?
Look, she's got a little money she saved. She's kept it hidden for years. Now, she wants to take it and leave, so let's let her go, huh?
I want to hear this all from Dorcas herself.
All right, here she comes. You asked.
Well, Dorcas, Joe John's been telling me some very interesting things about you.
What things? What have you been telling her, Joe John?
You still got your money safe on you, haven't you?
My money?
John, why would you tell her about that?
That's all right. Sister Love understands. Now, I explained to her now that Tippy's gone, so you just want to take your money and go away.
Oh, no, but I...
Sister Love doesn't object. Now, do you, Sister Love?
Well, no, of course not. But where are you going, child, if you leave here?
I don't know. Doesn't matter. Joe John's right. I want to go away. Any place.
Very well. Joe John can drive you wherever you want to go. But let's have our lemonade first, shall we?
Now, she was going to let us go so it would look as though we were on the run when she played her big rescue scene. But first, of course, the poison. The three glasses were still on the table where she'd set them. Sister Love lifted the pitcher and began to pour the lemonade. I deliberately turned my back on her. I have to wash my hands. Grave digging's dirty business.
You didn't have to help me bury Tippy. Could have done it by myself.
Oh, yeah? By yourself, huh? Your pa, too, I suppose.
Well, I was scared then. I could do it now. I'm not scared anymore.
You'll always be a scared little kid. No matter how old you get.
That's not fair, Joe John. You got no call to say
that. I see. Now you're bawling again. Listen, you better dry up if you want me to take you any place.
Now, let's all calm down with a nice cooling drink. Here you are, Dorcas. I'm sure Joe John didn't mean what he said.
Three seemingly civilized people sipping lemonade on a muggy summer afternoon. Now, what could be more innocent? I watched as Sister Love and Dorcas tipped their glasses to their mouths and drained them. I smiled, raised mine, and a little toast to them. And then I did the same.
I'm ready.
You're not going to take anything with you?
There's nothing here I want.
Well, come on then.
Goodbye, Sister Love. And just be glad that you're not ever going to heaven. Because Tippy's there and he'd only bark at you.
Well, looks like I was wrong. She's not a scared little kid anymore. Oh, by the way, you won't be leaving before too soon, will you, sister?
Not likely.
Oh, that's good. You see, Joe John Plunkett's beginning to believe, good Sister Love. And I sure wouldn't want you to miss it. Where I was taken. I mean, even if I didn't have an answer, well, I guess it doesn't matter to her, just so long as it's away from here. Well, that's the way I figured, too. I could see the house getting smaller and smaller in the rearview mirror. A wooden Uncle Sam in the yard and one arm raised in a farewell salute. The miniature painted windmills marching away into the distance reminded me of something. Another time, another place. That sweet 6 weeks in St. Angelo. Yeah. Bessie Spool and her old man and their miniature golf course. Something Bessie had once said to me was struggling to come up for air in my mind. Now, what was it? It was one of those soft summer nights. There were a few players still on the course. A couple of young lovers on about the ninth hole. Oh, they weren't in any hurry to finish their game. And a large, laughing family group just coming up on the 18th. I was the one with the miniature windmill that you had to hit the ball through.
Kind of a little fairyland it is, where people come to be together and be happy.
Yeah. That's what it looks like, all right. That little brook running through it and those little elves' houses, all those twinkling lights.
A magic kingdom with my old man and me as the king and queen. Everybody in the kingdom acting as carefree as children.
You know something, Bessie? I've even felt carefree here.
Been real nice having you, Joe John. Sort of like having a son. That's the one thing we miss. It would have been nice having some kids of our own. And I guess it just wasn't in the cards.
Suddenly, I knew why Bessie Spruill and San Angelo kept popping into my mind.
What are we stopping for?
There's a phone booth there. I'll make a call.
Who to?
Never mind. I'll be right back.
I went to the phone booth to make a call, like he said. I thought maybe I should try and get away while I had the chance. But I couldn't drive the car. Anyway, taking the key. But trying to get away on foot just didn't make sense. He could catch me too easy. But I didn't know where to go. So I just sat there in the car and waited like he told me to.
Well, you're in, kid. You got it made.
What are you talking about?
You got some money with you, haven't you?
You know I have.
You got enough for a one-way ticket to San Angelo?
Yeah, it's plenty. Well, where am I going to go in San Angelo?
To the Magic Kingdom, huh? To live with the King and Queen. You're going to like Bessie and her old man, Dorcas. And the place they live, too. Hey, it's even got a windmill in the front yard, like you used to.
Well, it sounds okay.
Everybody's happy there, huh? Even I was.
Then why aren't you coming too, Jojo?
Well, never mind about me. I just gonna do what I have to do, that's all.
I don't understand. Then I never have understood you very much.
Yeah, well, people can't always understand each other, Dorcas. Oh, you're going to have to be getting aboard.
Maybe you can come along later.
Look, kid, if I can ever make it to San Angelo, I'll be there, okay?
Okay.
Well, you got your ticket and your address?
I got it.
Now, you keep your money hid safe while you're on the train, you hear?
Oh, I will, don't worry.
I guess I don't have to worry about that.
Jojo, you never did answer me. Do you think I'm ugly? I mean, sister love isn't beautiful like
you
thought.
Oh, no, Dorcas. No, you're not ugly.
Well, my leg, I know that.
Your leg? I keep forgetting about that.
You do?
All I know is you got the damnedest green eyes I ever saw. Well, it was done then. Dorcas was saved. Some words from a book I'd read one time came into my head. It is a far, far better thing. Hell, I don't know what they meant, but I sure felt good, I'll tell you that. I felt better than I'd felt in a long, long time. Like a big weight had just been lifted off my back. Sister Laura was still in the kitchen where she was when we left her. Standing at the sink now, draining the glass. It was a glass of water, I was pretty sure of that. My own throat felt like I'd been wandering in the desert for days. That's the trouble with lemonade, it makes you thirsty.
What did you do?
Well, you might say I turned the tables on you. But switch the glasses would be more accurate. Hallelujah, sister.
But you couldn't have.
I went to the sink to wash my hands so that I could watch you in the shaving mirror. I saw you slip a powder into two of those glasses. Oh, you weren't easy to distract. But I managed with my little play-acting with Dorcas, remember? Only she wasn't play-acting.
But why?
Because you and I have one thing in common. We'll both be better dead than alive.
You and I?
You and I. That's cozy, isn't it?
And Dorcas, what did you do with her?
Well, she's out of it. I sent her away to the safest, sanest place I could think of. She's going to have a chance now anyway.
You fool. If you switched glasses, why Dorcas's? Why didn't you save yourself?
Oh, I wouldn't be a noble if that's what you're thinking. But you still wouldn't understand.
I only understand what you've done. Destroyed everything. Not just for me. For everybody.
All those millions of souls denied Sister Love's salvation, huh?
Yes.
Sinners don't want to be saved. That's straight from the horse's mouth, lady.
Fool.
What did you use?
Ergot. That stuff women take to bring on a miscarriage. That's easy to get.
So what happens now?
I don't know exactly.
Well, we just give a little wine and fall in our graves like Tippy, huh?
Sometimes see things before.
Are you seeing things?
My mother and father, that old bus driving down that mountain road. Only Uncle Mac and I are with them. We're sitting in the back. The bus is going fast. Too fast.
You better warn them. It's going to crash.
I'm trying to, but they're not paying any attention. They're just laughing and singing.
Why don't you just sing along with them, sister?
I can't. I don't know the song.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
That concludes this week's production of The Zero Hour. Stanton Forbes, If Two of Them Are Dead. Next week, we'll begin another exciting dramatization of a tale of mystery and suspense. We'll tell our story in 5 days, at the same time, Monday through Friday. So, on Monday, rest your eyes and listen here to The Zero Hour. I'm Rod Serling.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Ford Motor Company, MEM, and Sinoff. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater. Heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in Monday and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.